So I guess I want to just start by thinking about and talking to you about the why we did the review and why we felt that a focus on health inequalities for both our Black, Asian, minority ethnic communities and staff is so important at this particular moment. What are your thoughts on
that? Yeah, I mean, I think if we look back to the time in question, Robin, there was a huge amount of evidence about the impact that COVID was having on people from Black, Asian, and minority ethnic heritage. And we were certainly seeing that in our numbers, and the debate nationally was clear that that was the case. And then there was, right at the moment of the Black Lives Matter movement as well. So, you know, at that point, huge amount of noise. And I think we just wanted to take stock of what action we could take. And as a partnership, I think we're pretty good at saying, well, what can we be getting on with? Because some of the debate nationally, I think, was about the analysis and less about the action. So I think we wanted to focus on the action, given that, you know, 20% of our population come from those communities, and we wanted to do something about it.
We've got an independent chair, haven't we, for this review, and we and I think that's been a real asset and a real privilege to work with Professor Dame Donna Kinnear. Just why do you think that was important from your perspective?
I think it's worked out really well, and I think as a partnership, we've always welcomed a bit of external challenge, and I think as leaders, it's important to open ourselves up to that. As you say, we'd already committed to doing something around inequalities, about having representative leadership, recognizing that the degree of inequality faced by these communities was significant. So I think we felt like we're in a reasonable place, but we're asking ourselves the question, are we really, is there more that we could do? And we thought if we had an independent chair and someone who was as brilliant and direct and straightforward as Professor Dame Donna, then we'd get real value. And I think it's worked out that way. I think that kind of challenge and that open ourselves up to different voices has played throughout the review. And I've been really pleased with the contribution of the voluntary community and social sector. And it'd be worth just reflecting a bit on that, I think, Robin. You know, some of the people who've been involved and how they've shaped the recommendations.
Yeah, I mean, I think that the role of the voluntary community sector in both the co-production of the review, the way that we brought voices and unheard voices into the review, has been really powerful. And I know that from talking to Alison and Kim and others, that there will be a legacy from that. There'll be a legacy in the panel that will continue to work and challenge the system and the leaders in the system, quite rightly, to deliver on this review. So I think that's been incredibly powerful. And I think the voices of staff that we heard from with lived experience as employees, but lived experience in communities. And for me, there's something really powerful about this sort of holding up the challenge of what are multiple pressures in this. That and I think when we looked at sort of the impact of racial inequalities and white privilege and racism, that I think some of it is about the seeing of that. And we're talking last week or so to colleagues about this, what's on the work around that, and saying that sometimes the challenge is what you see, and you can't necessarily change something unless you see it, and then you can't necessarily dismantle something until you recognize what it is.
Yeah.
So I think that's been really powerful. And I just think that the and that's on top of what the pandemic itself has highlighted, and coming from a position where we have challenges that we knew were there, but then the Marmot report and then the pandemic. So this is all coming together in something that we really need to act on now, I think.
So I think one of the things that's really played out in what you described there is if you change the people, you change the conversation.
Yeah.
And the fact that we had different people in the room sharing their lived experience, their insight or their wisdom, meant you were able to see things that were probably hidden in plain sight. I really like the way you describe that, because it's so true. If you don't see it, you can't deal with it. And I think so many things we've been blind to be honest. I think I particularly like the way the process worked, actually, in terms of being agile. So I think we set off saying, look, we'll have three meetings and we'll focus on it this way. And it didn't quite work out that way, did it? It was slightly if hung off a similar frame.
Yeah. I think it was the ability to adapt to that. I mean, I think we both said, haven't we, that the quality of this product, the review itself, the document, and the thinking that goes, and the amount of engagement beneath it, is outstanding in the time that we've had. We probably overambitious at the early stages and thinking what we could achieve. And I'm just really glad that we flex that. I guess it's, I think what we have now is some real recommendations that are going to land.
So that combination of fantastic analytical input and insight, lived experience from people in our communities and in the third sector, and, you know, professional stewardship of a process, got us to those four big themes we were thinking about. You know, you've already described, you know, access to safe work for our staff, you know, the issues around mental illness in communities which are not addressed appropriately, or are not, services not tailored to be able to access easily, you know, the way that we lead and who the leaders are in the system and making sure they're representative, and the whole issue around commissioning and planning and thinking about how we design services. And I think we've ended up with a set of actions which to me look like a combination of activism and pragmatism. And I quite like that. So you know, let's have an anti-racism campaign then. So we're campaigning.
Yeah.
You know, let's have a new vehicle for tackling discrimination, which is made up of people from those communities, to independently look at discrimination. You know, this feels like sort of activism, doesn't it, in its best sense? And then some of the pragmatism around some of the processes that we've got of planning and commissioning and looking at the data.
It's just pretty scandalous, really, that the need to say again, and I think that the review that Kevin Fenton and Public Health England did nationally early in the year made this point as well, that the data that we have is just not where it needs to be. I think, I know, at local authority level, we know that the registration of death data without ethnicity and faith, we've been pushing that for now 6 months into the Home Office and not making progress, but we're doing it ourselves in Calderdale, we're doing it. And it's just, we're having those conversations and we're recording that information, finding that, you know, we're getting that data around about 93% of the time, which is giving us, which is robust. So some of those things, and then the way that we focus on mental health,
yeah.
I think the focus we had in the review on that, and it's tough right now for all of us, isn't it? For all our communities, and that we've got some sort of concrete sort of recognition of the role of community wealth building, and people looking out for each other, building on the campaigns we've done in neighbourhoods in the past. So there's a continuity to it, but it's actually going to shift us, I think. I think there's some the work around how we use resource, how we use our people resource, how we use our fiscal resource, our imagination and our energy. I think that we'll be challenged on that as leaders, I think.
Yeah. The leadership questions are really a really good one. And I think the fact that one of the recommendations is that personal pledge from people in leadership roles to say that, you know, inclusive leadership and standards around that are going to be enshrined and embedded in our organisations and the way we behave, you know, should make it real for everybody in a leadership role. The fact that if you take that and use the example you described around the death certification, you know, you particularly and people like Owen Williams have championed that because of you think it's right. Yeah. And I think that kind of turning that pledge into action, I'm really looking forward to. And then as a in my day job running an organization that provides significant support around mental illness in our communities, you know, just the actions around making sure that as we tackle the mental health consequences of the pandemic, we're doing that in a way which recognizes our different communities, that we plan for that, that we commission for that, that we consciously do that, feels to me like something that I'm really looking forward to getting my teeth into.
Yeah.
So we've got some real practical steps, as well as this activism, leadership, personal pledges, and then practical steps. It'd be worth just talking a bit about, you know, what the next steps are then, so we turn these recommendations into reality.
Yeah, so I think we've got a clear set of recommendations. We do need to kind of be clear about the actions we're going to deliver on this, and we do need to describe those in a really clear, accessible and meaningful way. I think we need to co-produce that plan. And I think that the last review meeting was really importantly focusing on that and how we will go about that with the same principle and approach that we've had in the review itself. That the it's really important that we think about workforce as well as communities in that, and how we make decisions and how we hold each other and the system to account, and accountability is right. And I think it's, I think rather than sort of, we sort of say, is this carrot versus stick? But I think this for me is something about, there should be opportunities and there should be consequences. And I think if we see that there are opportunities, that this is actually quite an engaging, energizing, inspiring thing. It's not something about people feeling, how do I do this? Am I doing the right thing or the wrong thing? I think it can be energizing. I found it really energizing.
Yeah.
But there are consequences if we ignore these issues for leaders, for our organizations and for our places.
Yeah, above all for our people.
Yeah,
one of the things that I've heard in my career, in the, you know, even in the last year or two, is, you know, of course we'd like more senior leadership from Black communities, from Asian communities, from other communities. There just isn't the talent, or there aren't people coming through, and it's just not true, is it? I mean, what we've seen in this process is how much talent there is out there. And how much talent and how much capacity that there is to put on this agenda if we just look. And like you, I think I've been completely inspired by, in the truest sense, you know, by the people that have been involved, the work that they've done, and the quality of the recommendations. And we have, now have to match that with the quality of the action. There's a worry that it becomes a fad, you know, and that's why I think these recommendations got to stick. That's why the action plan's got to work. That's why we're taking this to the partnership board in public to agree the recommendations and consider the action plan. So that, you know, on the public record, we're all saying, this is what we've found. Do you agree? This is what we're going to do about it. Do you agree? And that, I think, with the political, clinical, managerial leadership saying that, that gives me some real hope. And I think, you know, both of us would want to thank everybody who's been involved in this process. You know, in what is one of the toughest times people have lived through for a generation, I think we've focused on something that really matters, that strikes to the very heart of public service. You know, how do we deal with inequity, and how do we deal with the inequalities that people face? And the quality of the conversation, the quality of the inputs, the personal commitment of people has been outstanding. So I just want to say thank you to everybody, and to the chair, Professor Dame Donna Kinnear. You can access all of the papers that led to this report and the report itself on our website. It's available in alternative versions, easy read, several different language, and British Sign Language too. We want as many people as possible to consider what we've done and to join us in making the biggest difference that we can. Thank you.